All right, John, are you ready back there?
We're ready.
All right. Very good. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Seeing that it's a little after 7, about 5 after 7, I'd like to call this meeting to order. Welcome to the Town of Scituate Board of Selectmen's meeting for March 29th, 2011. First agenda item I'd like to address is an acceptance of the agenda.
Move to accept.
Moved by Mr. Norton.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Continuing along, are there any walk-ins this evening?
Yes.
Come on up, Mrs. Banger. I have a sense it's going to have to deal with maybe ship shape, or if not, the beautification, or both.
Well, ship shape is beautification.
Good evening.
Good evening.
And with you is?
Jean Schultnick, member of Sustainable Scituate.
Pleased to meet you.
So we're here to tell you that Ship Shape Day will be April 30th, Saturday, April 30th, from, we're going to be giving out supplies in front of Town Hall, as we always do, between 8 and 1. The bags, the trash bags are not being picked up until Monday, so we're encouraging people to do their cleanup anytime Saturday or Sunday. It's a busy weekend, and everybody has other things to do. So we realize that most of the trash collected is recyclable materials, and so we got in partnering with Sustainable Scituate, and that's why Jean's here.
So Sustainable Scituate would be pleased to participate again. We participated for the first time last year and helped to direct recycling out of the trash, and will be available to attend and be here at Town Hall in the morning that we're giving out the bags, and inform people what exactly is recyclable, what can be diverted from the waste stream, and the bags will be, the recycling bags will be identified with a red ribbon. So red for recycling, and then the regular trash bags will be for the trash.
Are there just designated spots for pickup, or is it just along the roadside like it was last year, or what's the?
It's just, you know, the Highway Department does a great job of getting things on Monday morning, and so in the past, it's pretty much, people have pretty much kind of put stuff together in clusters, so that's always appreciated, and, but wherever it is, we'll find it and pick it up. So last year, we had something like 500 bags we gave out, and we felt like, you know, we didn't take, don't have an exact count, but somewhere between a third and a half were tied with the red ribbon. So that's something like 200, 250 bags that didn't go into the waste stream.
Good.
We didn't have to pay to dispose of, so.
Mr. Harris?
Is that the weekend, the end of April vacation or the weekend after?
The weekend after.
Oh, good, all right.
Which is always a, April vacation, we try to avoid those two weekends.
Good.
So we hope to see you all there.
Good.
I'll be there.
Anything else from the board? We'll keep reiterating it. I can assure you on that, so.
Thank you.
Good, thank you very much. Any other walk-ins? All right, moving on to the next agenda item. It's number 3, meet the new IT director. Is Mr. Sheehan here?
There he is.
Mr. Sheehan, come on up. Just introduce yourselves. Welcome to the town, and welcome to taking over and helping out with our IT.
Thanks very much. Thanks for having me. Very exciting opportunity, and I really think we'll have a more reliable, more secure, more standardized network and operations over time.
Good.
Okay.
Just a comment, Mr. Chairman. I understand, just talking to some of the department heads and some of the people in the offices, he's already done, been a giant help to people in helping them do things that they wanted to do for a while, so he's already started. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe.
Did the same thing. Thanks.
Yeah, and Tricia forwarded your resume out. It's impressive, and we're looking forward to making changes in the town and improving the system, so.
As am I.
Yeah.
Good. Well, thank you again. We look forward to working with you, all right?
Likewise, thank you.
Have a good night. Moving on to the next, which is agenda item number 4. It's the accommodation for the high school boys ice hockey. Gentlemen, welcome, and thank you very much for coming. Obviously, we wanted to take an opportunity to thank you, thank Mike Breen and the coaches for a wonderful job, you know. You know, when you're dealing with school, it's certainly very important to study scholastically, because life moves on. You're going to be moving on to bigger and better things, but simultaneously, it's always fun to have extracurricular activities. It makes school that much more, I think, worthwhile. It gives you more of a profound appreciation for what you're actually doing, because it's not all sports. But what you guys have been able to accomplish as a team, not just for this year, but in for the past number of years, is to demonstrate both scholastically and education and from a sports standpoint that you can do both things. And you know, we commend you all for the wonderful season you had. Like everything, sometimes it doesn't end the way you always want it to or expect it to, but hopefully what you can take away from that is a better thing about yourself, a better thing about life, and certainly a profound appreciation for your teachers, and in particular your coach as a teacher, or coaches. And with that, I just want to say thank you, because you know a lot of people in this town do watch and follow, and they get, you bring a lot of joy, unbeknownst to yourselves, that people do enjoy watching the sport, seeing what happens, both the wins and the losses. So you represented the town very well, and Tony Vignani is going to read to you the accommodation that we're going to be providing you all. But we want to thank you very much, and I know that you know some of you may be moving on to other sports, some of you are going to be graduating, some of you are going to continue to move up. But regardless, just make sure you keep those two principles, you know, the team spirit, but also respecting your elder, you know, I say respecting your elders, no, I sound like a parent, respecting your parents, your teachers, and certainly your coach, because they're teaching you life lessons that you will be able to apply. So with that, I'll let Tony share with you what we've put together for you.
Now, do we want to, I mean, I can read this, but this actually goes through all their names. Do we want to actually have them come up one at a time and get there? Get a minute on TV to wave to your.
Why not? Those who are here. Thank you.
You know, John just pretty much commented on what the letter is. We want to thank you and congratulate you for your success this year. And I think what we want to do first is acknowledge the 10 seniors, if you're here. So, Sean, you want to hand that to them?
Sure.
So I'll read off the names, and if I butcher your name, I apologize in advance. First one I got, though, Dave Lyons. Is Dave here?
Thank you, Dave.
Harold Gerbus.
Thank you. Congratulations.
How are you, buddy?
Good to see you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
How are you?
Good
to see you.
Congratulations.
Great job. Devin Flynn. And again, these are all the seniors.
Congratulations.
Great job.
Devin, good job. Matt Burt. He's not here. Mitch Warren.
Congratulations.
Mitch, good job. Congratulations.
Well, Mitch. Charles Spalt. Not here. Cam Rosada. Frankie Sheehan. That didn't come from a game, did it?
Earlier on.
Oh.
Congratulations.
Good job. Congratulations.
Good job, Frank. Andrew Mitchell. And Kevin Cox.
Kevin, congratulations.
Good job.
Good job. So, Mike, those are the seniors. Congratulations on a great 4 years. And good luck in your next endeavor. Now, these are all the other players. Matt Gentile.
Matt, congratulations.
Good job, Matt.
Brendan O'Neill. Tucker Seesaw. In lacrosse, yeah. Mike Orr. Chris D'Angelo. Looks like a younger brother here. Curtis Spalt. Didn't make it either. Josh Beck.
Josh, congratulations.
Good job, Josh.
Johnny Callahan.
Congratulations, good job.
John, way to go.
Dan Del Grosso? I see Jack O'Donohue in the back there.
Jack, congratulations.
Congratulations.
Joe, Jack. Next, Alex Way?
Alex, thank, good job.
Job, Alex. Cam Mitchell? Cam here? Michael Hassett?
How are you, Michael? Good to see you.
Jack Reedy?
Yeah. How are you? Good to see you.
Reedy, it's good to see you, good job.
Job, Jack. Joey Spinella? And lastly, Mike Susi. Am I missing one?
Anyone not get called?
Anyone not get called?
What about this gentleman back here?
Right down here.
You get the special treatment.
It happens.
Matt Murray.
Congratulations, Lee.
Congratulations, you're on the.
Congratulations, Matt.
Good golfer, too. Good job, Matt.
Is he?
Okay, yes. And we'd also take a second to recognize the coaches. Kevin Duggan. Eric Steverman. Jamie Kelly. Bob Rosada. Brad Warren. And head coach Mike Breen.
Thank you, Mike. Well, we look forward to next year, gentlemen, and we look forward for those who are moving on to do well. So, again, thank you very much. All right?
You guys can stay for the rest of the meeting if you like.
Thank you.
Welcome. Okay, moving on to the next agenda item. It's a discussion vote to set the poll hours for the town election, which is now set for May 7th, 2011.
Is Bernice still here, I wonder?
Yes, here she comes.
Bernice, we're on agenda item number 5 to set the poll hours. Did you want to address anything or just to set the meeting? Okay.
John, before you go, before we start, take that.
Sorry. Want a motion?
Please.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to set the poll hours for May 7th, the annual town election, from 8 a.m. until 5 p.m.
Second.
Second by Mr. Harris. Discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Aye.
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 It's unanimous.
Just one quick note, there were no, no one ran against any of the incumbents, so. There are no contested races for any of the.
Just, I know we're just taking the vote, and I guess I was a little slow on the draw. But when there's no contested races at all, it seems to be a long time to be open. And, you know, and I.
But there will be ballot questions, possibly?
There'll be a ballot question, okay.
That was my reasoning, because the override question is.
That explains it. Yep, that explains it. Thank you.
So we're moving on to the next agenda item, which is the discussion vote, Hawker Peddler's license for North Scituate's Farmers Market. And the first one we have here is Something Sweet from Lisa Talbot. Is she here by chance?
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman, that's just a renewal on that one. The other
motion.
One is a new license.
Sure.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to renew the Hawker Peddler's license for Something Sweet for 2011 in accordance with all inspections by the Board of Health.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Unanimous. All right, moving on to the next one, which happens to be Gerritsen Cranberry Farm, I think doing Dell's Lemonade. Is that correct? I thought just Gerritsen Cranberry Farm.
No.
Gerritsen's
doing business as Dell's
Lemonade. Withdrew
at the last moment and sent on to Dell's.
Dell's, okay. Who's here for Dell's? Come on up. Are you
Susan Franklin?
Come on up, Ms. Franklin. And am I mistaken? Have you applied before in the town?
Yes, okay, in 2008. I had a license for the beaches. I'm interested in the farmer's market this year, and I've done a number of farmer's markets in the area, but I have not done Scituate yet. I think last year was the first year for your market, and I'd like to participate in that. We do a number of events in Scituate, the Heritage States Festival. In fact, I recognize a few of you guys from the Heritage States. So.
Just two questions. So you'd be applying to go into Heritage Days separate and apart from?
Right.
From the Hawkers Peddlers license, that's number one. The second one is, do you do, not that I mean, Saturday, do you do a farmer's market on Saturday also, or outside of the town of Scituate, or, just curious?
On Saturdays, we do two. We do one in Braintree and one in Hingham.
Just out of curiosity, that's all. Questions from the board?
So this is just for the farmer's market?
That's correct. I think I was advised that if we wanted to do something else, we would do it under a separate meeting.
Motion?
Please.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a Hawker Peddlers license to South Shore Refreshments LLC, DBA Dell's Lemonade, of 142 Lambert's Lane, Cohasset, to sell frozen refreshments at the North Scituate town-owned commuter rail parking lot in front of the WPA building from 3 p.m. to 7 p.m. on Wednesday from May 1st to December 1st, 2011. This license has a temporary waiver of the 15-minute rule, Selectmen Policy Number 43-99.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Further discussion, any questions? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Congratulations and good luck. That completes agenda item number 6. Moving to agenda item number 7, it's an update on the Pier 44 Committee. Mr. DeSalvo, good evening. I assume you're presenting.
Evening.
So what good news can you share with us? Everybody's been asking and trying to figure out, so what's been going on?
I could talk for a long time, but I'm going to save that for the public forum to get people to show up.
That's okay.
What I'd like to do, with the board, is just to go through what we've been doing, kind of a bullet list of what we've been doing from the first time that we met in November up until most recently. And then if you have any particular questions, then we can get down into the details, if that's all right.
Sure.
Okay, great, thank you. We had our initial kickoff meeting on November 29th. The board got together for the first time with the town administrator, and Sean Harris attended as well. And we received our instructions on what the charge was, and we moved forward from there. We've been meeting in general every 2 weeks, mostly on Monday evenings. And initially, we were going through a lot of boxes of documents that were provided by the town and various departments in the town. We really appreciate the input that the various town departments have been giving us in their support. If we have questions, they're right there to answer questions for us. We had a lot of documents to go through, and we've been still sorting through documentation as it becomes available. And these documents include files from the building department since the time when the building was put up in 1957, all through the various additions that were put on, ZBA files, planning board files, and such. We also, back in January, at the town administrator's request, we went through the existing building to do a conditions assessment. We were asked to take a look at things that really had to be fixed right away. I know the goal is to reopen the building for some more meeting space until the final disposition is decided. So we went through the building, developed a punch list of items that we thought should be fixed right away, and provided that to the town administrator. And I understand it's also been sent to the DPW director as well. We've been through the building at least 3 times as a committee, looking at different issues within the building. As I mentioned, we've been reviewing various files that came from the department, various town departments. We've been also looking at various codes, the current building code, what the effects are on the existing building. We've been looking at the zoning regulations, other regulations such as environmental, floodplain, and any constraints that might be on the property. So we've been kind of looking at it from a big picture standpoint, because we don't really know what's going to go there yet. So we're trying to find out what the constraints are with that particular piece of property with the building. We also reviewed the MBTA's use restrictions. We did have some questions for the town administrator, and she was kind enough to get us some feedback on that from the town's attorney. It's our understanding that the MBTA imposed the use restrictions on the town as part of receiving the funding from the MBTA. So we got the answers that we needed as far as the use restrictions, which was very helpful. Back in February, we conducted an online public survey, and I'm happy to say that we received over 1,000 responses. The survey entailed, and I'm sure you've seen it yourself, the survey entailed asking the public for their ideas for what to put on the property, be it a building structure or just a park, tear down and construct a park on the whole site, keep the building there, construct a park, or a number of other uses that we put on the questionnaire. We also allowed for the public to, under a category called other, they could add their comments. And to say we got a lot of comments, we had well over 100 pages of comments on the survey in addition to the 1,000 responses. So a lot of data, a lot of good information was provided to the committee through the survey. We also provided survey documents to the various town departments and committees, and we got a lot of good feedback from the town departments on what they see their needs are, potential use of the property. And as I mentioned, we're planning a public forum. It's scheduled for April 30th. It's a Saturday from 1 p.m. until 4 p.m. in the high school auditorium. And it's going to start off as a PowerPoint presentation. We'll bring the committee, we'll bring the public up to speed on what the committee's been doing, what we're doing, why we're doing it, what our charge is. And we're also going to provide our current conclusions and recommendations on potential uses for the property. And the hope by doing that presentation is to, as part of this forum, is to obtain additional information, additional feedback and ideas from the public on the presented potential uses. And we're still in the planning phase for this particular forum. It will start off as a PowerPoint presentation, and then as we further develop the agenda for the forum, we'll have more details for the board on that. But it's definitely set for that date and time. You've also received some clarification. We had some questions on the committee's charge as provided by the Board of Selectmen. We did receive clarification on the charge. So been doing a lot. The committee's been working very hard for the last several months, and we've got a lot done, still a lot to do, but we're getting there. I think we have the raw data that we need, and after the public forum is held and we obtain any additional data, we'll be able to, probably within 4 weeks after the public forum, have a draft phase one report for your board to review. And then after receiving any comments, we can finalize the report and conclude phase one.
Great.
That's where we stand. Do you have any particular questions on any of the comments?
Norton?
Just one, and thank you for the job you guys have been doing all along. There's 1,000 ideas out there of what to do with it. So you have the unwelcome task of trying to narrow down. And let me ask you a question. I forget. How was it determined who the survey was mailed to?
It actually, the survey wasn't mailed out in an effort to save money. Mm-hmm. We actually used SurveyMonkey, an online survey tool. We created the survey document, and it was posted online. And what we did to advertise it to the public is we did a number of things. We sent posters around to different departments in the town. We put advertisements in the Mariner. They also wrote a very nice article, as well as the Patriot Ledger. They both had nice articles about the project and the work of the committee. So the online survey information and link was put in both the newspapers, plus on their online sites. They had online articles as well for both newspapers. WATD also did a public service announcement several times for us, announcing the online survey. We also used the town's email system. Anyone that signed up to receive emails from the town automatically got notices about the survey, as well as the school department was good enough to allow us to use their email system. So anyone that subscribes to this Scituate school system's email system got all the emails about the links. And we do have a website on the Scituate Town website, and we also put a notice on that and a link as well directly on the website.
Okay. Thank you.
Welcome.
Mr. Harris?
Just a couple of comments. I met with Ed just a couple of days ago, and my question at that time was, had anybody submitted a comment or an idea that, you know, was just, you know, that we didn't think of? And then he had a couple, but it was only a couple. And what were they, community pools or something like that, swimming pools?
That was just some of the
ideas. I was hoping someone would come up with an idea that none of us thought of, and a wonderful idea. And just another comment to Jonathan and yourself, that I know how many hours you've met over the past few months, and I thank you very, very much.
You're welcome.
Spent a lot of time, and I'm sure you're going to continue that until you finish this, but thank you.
Just one, I guess, quick question, and this maybe this is what you're going to go over in the presentation. You sent us all this raw data, and every time I started reading it and I thought I understood it, I turned the page and I started saying, did I really understand it? Mm-hmm. So is that what the next step is, to really explain this to the public? Or what, you know, I guess everyone can interpret it a little bit differently.
Right, that's right.
But at some point, is there going to be a session to kind of try and figure out what all of this means? You know, great data, great, breaks it down 100 different ways where you rank things and strongly approve or not approve. But I was a little confused as to if there was a dominant theme, and everything I thought, every time I thought I saw one, I turned the page and thought it was something else. So what's the step in terms of understanding the data?
What we're going to do, it's in my court now to put the raw data up on our internet site, the town website. I'm going to convert the survey into PDF files. I'm going to try to annotate some of the pages that are confusing, so that the public will hopefully understand how to read various questions and various pieces of data. So we're going to get I'm going to make PDF files and have that posted on the website, so that'll be accessible to the public to look at. But we will, during the public forum, we're going to try to convert there's a lot of data, a lot of percentages, a lot of numbers. We're going to try to convert those into various charts to make it more straightforward, be it a pie chart or some type of a graph that would show, based on a particular proposed use, this is how many people felt, had a strong opinion that they'd like to see out there. So we'll consolidate the data and provide some PowerPoint slides that convert it more to graphics, because one could get lost reading all this raw data. And the comments, the same thing. We received over 100 pages of comments in addition to the raw data that I provided to your board. And we're going to try to consolidate that to what the general themes are, what the general comments are, because some of the comments don't always match up necessarily with some of the raw data.
Right. Particularly the kind where you rank. You know, it went through the most used on, if you guys are looking, number 8. And you had to rank senior programs and 1, 2, or 3, or you know, that part was a little confusing to me, how, you know, if there was a dominant theme out there, and I didn't see that there was one that clearly jumped off the page that this is what everyone wants to do with it. Is that your initial glance at it also?
We've actually concluded, we did study the data over several weeks and several committee meetings, and we looked at not only the raw data, the response counts, and the percentages per each response, but we're actually able to, with the survey, we can look at the comments, and you can back the comment back to the individual who actually filled out a particular survey. It was an anonymous survey, so naturally we don't know who sent in the comment, but you can look at themes from the comments and match it up with how people actually voted when they went through the survey. And we did find couple of dominant themes as far as preferences, and I would call these preliminary, but based on the data, to give the board a general idea, there's a very strong preference to construct a park, to keep it open space down there, maintain views of the water, not a marina. A lot of the comments was don't put another marina down there, but a very, very strong preference for park space, open space for the community as a whole. And we'll be further looking at that, and that will be one of the topics at the forum. I'll call the second place use is actually a combination of a number of the uses that were in the survey. The general theme with that is to provide a community center on the site for all ages, not to restrict it to any one demographic, and also to have it as a multifunctional building. We're also investigating if we can glean from the data in the comments a third use to look at during the forum, but that's a little more difficult because everything starts becoming equivalent at that point for the most part. There is a very strong feeling by the public that whatever goes down there needs to generate revenue so that the town's not paying to operate whatever's down there. So it's generating enough revenue to pay for all the expenses, pay for the operating costs. So that's something that our committee is continuing to look at, what the options are. Now, that being said, the use restrictions, I'm not sure if you want to get into all the detail, the use restrictions are very particular about not putting commercial uses down there to generate revenue. It's got to be a revenue source that complements what the use restrictions are, which are recreational, educational, open space. So it would restrict a restaurant-only use. But it wouldn't discount if there was a community center put in a secondary use within that facility, since the facility, say, would primarily be a community center, a secondary use, they could have a little snack bar, and then it generates revenue to pay, help pay for the operations, just as an example. So those are the main themes that we've been seeing.
So it's good. So we'll be looking to hear the forums. Going to be held on Saturday, April 30th, 1 to 4. Thereafter, probably around June 1st, after Memorial Day, the board could expect to see a preliminary, I don't want to say plan, but report.
That's correct.
That I assume then thereafter you'd come back to us, we'd have a chance to review it, and then finalizing it after further comment.
Correct.
No decisions have been made. This is just data that you've been able to, the committee's been able to compile and hopefully extrapolate, you know, different types of uses. So. Great. Ed, both you and Mr. Warner have done, and all committee members, you know, worked very hard. We appreciate it very much.
You're welcome.
Other questions at all? Questions from the audience?
At auditorium, high school auditorium, right?
It's the high school auditorium.
High school auditorium?
At the April 30th, the forum.
April 30th is the forum, yes.
Whereabouts?
It's a high school auditorium.
The auditorium. Good.
Everyone's invited. Come on down.
Good. Thank you very much, Ed.
Thank
you, Jonathan. All right. Moving on. Agenda item number 8 is... that should have been amended earlier on, that we're no longer going forward with number 8. That's been taken care of. So I'd like to skip over to agenda item number 9, which is a discussion vote on summer water restrictions. And I don't know, is Al going to be here also? Or Mr. DeBarros, I know you're here. I didn't know.
Al's going to be here.
I thought, Mr. Rose, how are you?
If need be, I'll
see if we can grab him.
Yeah.
Skip to the next one, but that might take a little while too, so I don't want to. You're already set up.
Here he is.
Here we go. Good. Good evening, Al.
You guys are really moving along tonight. My goodness.
All right. Efficiency.
How would you get to your topic? It's so interesting.
Well, we are here as the Water Department, Department of Public Works. The Water Resources Committee, from our oldest member in the committee, I mean most senior time on the committee, to our newest appointee. Thank you very much.
Young yeah. Works.
I could have said that too, but I wasn't sure where to go. All right, well, we're here tonight to recommend some changes to our summer watering restrictions that we believe will greatly benefit all 7,600 of our water customers by reducing the need to implement the severe water restrictions we've had to implement in two of the 3 years that I've been here, and several years before that as well. Here's the problem. We all know that water demand increases in the summer because people are involved in outdoor activities, taking more showers. There's more fun things to do in the backyard with the water hose and the kids playing and pools to fill and lawns to water. And also our population goes up in Scituate, primarily in Marshfield. We see a much bigger population, in Humorock, a bigger population increase there than on the mainland, but nonetheless, throughout town, population goes up, even if just visitors in town. Well, so during the dry periods of the summer, our water usage increases dramatically. And as a matter of fact, here's a new chart I've just got for you to look at, if I may. And this is over the last 5 or 6 years. You see what happens to the water consumption in Scituate. As we all know, it goes way up. But how much does it go up? It doubles in the summer. So our water production needs to double in the summer. Now, at some point, when we reach these peaks, the water treatment plant and our reservoir cannot keep up with the demands of our customers, and we have to implement mandatory water bans to prevent the drop in our water pressure, which could affect our firefighting capabilities. And we want to avoid that at all costs. Now, the primary purpose of us having a municipal system, I believe it first was built in order to provide water for firefighting, and then it was also expanded to include water for human consumption. And those really are the two reasons we have a municipal system: safe water for people and sufficient pressure and volume of water to fight fires. We have gone through, after looking at this chart, to analyze the consumption pattern of our 7,600 customers to find ways that we can ensure good supply all summer long. And it struck us that the single largest impact on the increase in summer water demand is not the population growth. It's something very simple. It's in-ground lawn irrigation systems connected to our municipal system. If you look at this chart over here on the wall, this represents a two-year period, January through December of 2009 through 2010. This line right here represents the monthly consumption of the 200 median customers, the 200 average customers in our system. And that represents water consumption of about 10,000 gallons per month. And you notice there are peaks in the summertime months right here, these being the summer months. This represents the consumption pattern of our 200 largest household customers. And you would expect they are larger households generally, and their fundamental use of water is greater. They may have, for whatever reason, they consume more water, more family members, more bedrooms, more bathrooms. But the big thing is that the peak in the summertime is huge. These two peaks right here are huge. And this water right here, this consumption of this water right here, this doubling, this was tripling of normal consumption, this is doubling of normal consumption. It's because of these bumps that we end up going on water time summer restrictions. We just drain the system of water and we are not able to keep up. So the reservoir drops, the pressure drops, we're running the plant 24 hours a day, and we have to go on restrictions. So we end up imposing on everyone in town watering restrictions because of these particular humps right here. Okay? Now, these humps, by the way, right here, the amount of water to fill this demand right here placed in the system is equivalent to the complete production of one of our wells. So we basically run one of our municipal wells all summer long to supply lawn watering. Now, I say 200 customers. There's more than 200 people with irrigation systems in town, and I have to admit I have an irrigation system in town, okay? So I'm not exempt from placing unusual demands on the town. The water used by these irrigated systems drives us to the mandatory restrictions, and everybody has to go on restrictions. So the Water Resources Committee and the Water Department conclude that the most effective way to make an immediate impact to conserve water for its two primary purposes, which are household use and for firefighting, is to implement reasonable restrictions on the use of our municipal water, which we source, treat, sanitize, and deliver to homes. Put restrictions on how much that water can be used for lawn irrigation. And by doing this, we think we can reduce or perhaps in many years eliminate the needs for mandatory bans on our water system in Scituate. So here's what we're recommending. And John will pitch in here and help here because in his professional capacity has a great oversight of what's going on throughout Massachusetts. But many communities in Massachusetts limit or restrict the use of lawn irrigation systems. And these restrictions range from an outright ban on lawn irrigation systems. Some towns limit the size of the lawn that you can sprinkle. Others impose requirements for more sophisticated electronic monitoring of soil conditions and such. And then others impose limitations on the days of watering. the DEP and the Mass Waterworks Association lawn professionals and conservation consultants are consistent in saying that watering lawns once per week deeply is best for the grass and best for the water supply. And so what we're recommending is that we put in a routine, and the routine would be from Memorial Day through Labor Day, everyone can use their in-ground watering system one day per week. And that day per week will be assigned in a way that you know which is your day. And the way we would recommend assigning it is to assign it based upon the precinct in which your home is located. So in precinct one, people would water on Monday. Precinct two, they'd water on Tuesday. Then, if the reservoir continues to drop and we have to impose restrictions, we would do that. But those would be the two steps. One, let's begin to level out this hump here by watering one day per week and in those lawn irrigation systems. And then two, if we have to, if we can't, if we have a really dry summer, we may still have to impose additional restrictions. But what happens now is that when people are watering and using up all the systems and we go on restrictions, they end up not being able to water anyway, because once we impose a ban, you cannot use water outside. So that's harder for a lawn to be well watered for half the summer and then have to go on withdrawal, complete withdrawal, no watering whatsoever. So that's what we're proposing. Let's put our lawns into a position where they receive the once per week treatment and avoid, we believe, the need to go to absolute restrictions. So these restrictions would apply to municipal water. If people had a private well, they would register it with the water department as free. We provide a sign saying private well in use, be a place where people could post it so that they're not going to get fees or fines rather for using that system. And we'd have to call back and forth and say, you know, I've got a well and blah, blah, blah. So the idea is to put some order into the system. If you have a well, get it registered, no cost, no restrictions on it. It's just, you know, here's the sign. And now how are we going to tell people about this if you agree with it? The Water Department, the Resources Committee, and the North-South River Watershed Association have obtained a grant from the Division of Ecological Restoration, a conservation grant. And by the way, conservation is not, it's mandatory. Conservation is mandatory. When we go to apply for or reapply for our water permit, we have to show what conservation measures are in place in town. And if we were ever to apply, need more water from the ground to apply for another well, we would have to first show that we've got obtained that through very severe conservation measures. So these are all in the direction of that. In that regard, then, North-South River Watershed Association was able to obtain a grant to provide information on this, on any kind of restrictions and on conservation. And what we would do is have an informative mailer to every water customer explaining the irrigation requirements and the day that the individual would be able to water with their lawns, with their irrigation systems, newspaper notices, radio announcements, webcast, email blast, Channel 10, signage, and strategic locations. So that's kind of what we want to talk with you about tonight. And as water commissioners, have you hopefully ask a lot of good questions and then support what we're recommending.
Just a few questions. I know with we can't regulate wells that people own. I mean, the reason why I'm asking that is because it seems like, okay, the town water supply we can regulate, but people can keep their water on all day long in the midst of a ban and use their water, well water, which is going to draw from the same source of water that we as a town are drawing from. I just think that's incredibly unfair.
We can regulate it, but we can't right now. We would have to pass a bylaw, and it would have to be vetted somehow with the state. But then that's very
conceivably
that's a reasonable approach to take. It's just that as right now, the purview of our water commissioner role is the municipal water supply system.
Fair enough. I'm just thinking generally, conceivably, you could have a well water next door and somebody on town water, and they could be doing it constantly, and the people who are on town water are going to be subjected to whatever we decide.
Yeah.
Mr. Denny, if I may, the Water Resources Committee, because of the situation with our water permit, which will be renewed soon, we are committed to a conservation plan. We will redo the town's water conservation plan. This is meant to be a first step in that general direction, because as we go forward and as the town continues to grow, we're gonna face a serious situation with the water resources, as we've been discussing for a number of years. So by next year at this time, I would tell you that the Water Resources Committee will be coming back with a draft plan to you, and we see this as a first step in that in the general right direction. We're going to need to do this. We will be we may be suggesting adjustments to bylaws just as we are discussing now. The committee is reviewing that. We've got a subcommittee working on that as we speak right now. But the Water Resource Committee feels very strongly that this proposal is a good first step in the right direction in getting the town set up to do conservation of its water resources, which are critical.
Good. I would like to see the Water Resource Committee or address that, because that's, I know it's not the Water Department, but I just think that's something that, looking at this issue right off the top of my head, I'm thinking, well, if we're dealing with trying to conserve water, then we've got to do it across the board with people who have wells, too. But anyway, I'm glad to hear that. I know it's not a part of the discussion tonight, but it just came up in my review of these proposals. So, Joe, you had your hand up.
A couple of things. And the water permit jumped out at me also. I think it's we have to be proactive in that, rather than at the last minute when we were applying for that permit, all of a sudden try to come up with ways to conserve water that we can put on a piece of paper to turn in to give us a better shot at the permit. I think it's, you know, certainly not too early to think and work in that direction. I do have a couple of questions, if I may ask. During the summer, even those homes with an in-ground watering system, that would only be, if we pass this tonight, only be allowed to use one day a week their in-ground. Would they be allowed to water as much as they wanted with a hand hose?
Yes.
So they could go out there if they saw their grass browning, you know, in between, they could go out and water it by hand.
Or bushes, if you put in bushes.
You could water them.
Yeah, you could water those.
Gardens as well.
Okay. The other thing, and this is always a question I have, is the enforcement of this, as well as other things. How do you perceive this being enforced?
We took a shot at that last summer when we had odd even day watering. Basically, the water cops, the water department, goes around and is, you know, in finding watering systems running at the wrong time. People are given a warning because maybe they missed the news on it. And the warning consists of a yellow door hanger, so we right at the property or on the mailbox itself. And then with a subsequent, if somehow they missed the message, then it would end up, they would be given a fine. And the fine would, it begins at
$50
a day and then goes up to $100 a day. And then those fines are simply added to the water bill. And so they're due when the water bill is due and they're paid or contested. And we issued quite a few fines last summer. It got some people's attention, and others seemed immune to it. But nonetheless, that's unfortunately part of the business. Now, this would mean that you know what day you're going to water. It's no longer confusion. Oh, gee, is my house number even, and it's an even day? What day of the week is it? So we try to make it as simple as we can, yet mm-hmm. consistent with people's ability to.
Thank you. That's my question.
John?
A couple of questions and a comment. The consumers that have irrigation, do they have 2 meters or do they have just 1 meter?
One.
Would there be an advantage, Jimmy, to having them have two, have a second one? Or would that, you know, that'd be a long-term project, I understand. But
There are some, I think there are some people have talked about, there are some places that have asked for a second meter for whatever reason, but it's like a $6,500 connection fee.
Right.
Most people find that not worth doing. And I'm not sure what the advantage would be to the homeowner anyway.
No, I wasn't really thinking the advantage to the homeowner, but the advantage to this town. If someone wants to, you know, you're proposing one idea, but if I wanted my grass green at any expense, then maybe I could pay one rate for the potable water, another rate to keep my grass green. I don't know. But if it was triple the amount of money, then, you know. All right, okay. All right, it was just, all right.
We like the revenue.
Right.
If I may, Sean, we did address some other options. We've done quite a bit of work in preparation for this meeting.
Oh, I'm sure you did.
One of the things that we discussed was increasing the tiered costs. And the problem with that is that there are so many exceptions to it that we would be overcharging certain places, like if there's one water meter on a development or on a multi-family dwelling, okay. Those people would be incurring additional costs. So
disadvantage.
Right. So I think long term there are some other solutions. And again, hopefully as we look at this conservation plan longer term, we can make some recommendations and possibly give those things as options to the residents of town if they want to spend the money to get themselves into a special situation.
And one other thought, and you know, we've done this for quite a few years now and implemented water restrictions. And one thing that always, as I'd be driving around town, that would really irritate me is people watering their lawns during the day. How much, you guys are the experts, how much is being wasted by watering your lawn during the day versus at night? It just would drive me crazy. Have you, 90% is wasted, evaporated? That's unbelievable.
One thing that drives me crazy is, while it makes it easier to do some policing, you can kind of find out who's watering by the amount of water running down the street.
Yeah, right.
Which goes to Joe's discussion he had earlier is that, you know, people will water in the street because the systems, they're put in, they're probably regulated well when they're put in, but over time, they become improperly set, improperly maintained, and the water going out at 2 to 3 gallons per minute is watering the street, the side of the house, the driveway. And just for perspective, 2 to 3 gallons per minute, that means that in an hour of running a sprinkler system at 2 to 3 gallons per minute, you're using what the average family uses, what the average consumer uses in a day. 68 gallons per day is what our average customer in town is using. 68 gallons per person per day is our average. And a sprinkler system uses that in 1 hour.
Amazing. Tony.
Yeah. I'll start by saying I'm all for conservation and finding some way to help the water, you know, and us conserve that and not run into problems in the future. When I first read this, I thought it was very extreme, and I've spoken to Al about this. I thought that going from really a system where people can do whatever they want now to giving them one specific day a week that they can do it is not going to be considered reasonable restrictions to a lot of people, particularly, you know, the 200-plus families that are watering probably in an excessive amount. So I thought that the jump was very extreme, and I didn't know how you could set a policy that would really be almost stricter than that. You know, I mean, you could set a ban that's stricter than that and say no one can water their lawns, but I don't know how we could set a policy where you would say you can't water your grass at least one day a week. So as I had spoken about, I was hoping that we could find some sort of measure. It seems to me that's a big leap to get to that point, and is there some sort of modified path that we can get to see if we need to get to that point? You know, last summer was particularly dry, you know, one of the driest that I can remember. And it, you know, obviously it shows in the chart over there. The ban that we had last year in a very, very bad summer was odd even. So it was every other day.
Odd even and then full.
Yeah. So when was it full?
In August.
So towards the end of the summer, you know, so, you know, through, when did the, maybe in July is when we went odd even.
But even with that ban, look at this curve here.
Yeah. Well, I mean, obviously hit September and it goes off because people aren't watering the lawn anymore. But, you know, so we got through May, through July, then we went to odd even, and then in August we went complete ban. So that, even with a bad summer, you know, that isn't even as bad as the policy that we're looking to put into place now, in my opinion. So, you know, I was wondering, are hoping that we could find some sort of way to see if we can do something a little bit less stringent and see if it has an impact that can help us get where we want to go without going to this extreme. And somebody mentioned a minute ago, I think you did, you know, education. People just don't know that they shouldn't be watering during the day, you know, that they should be watering at night. And then, you know, if we put them on a one-day restriction, are people going to water for 8 hours on their day and use just as much money as they would if they watered for, I don't have an assistant, but how many hours a morning do you do it? You know, 2 hours or something? You know, is it going to add up to the same amount of water because people are just going to drown their lawns for the one day that they're able to do it? So I'm all for taking steps in that direction. I just think that these steps are stronger than I'd like to go to start. I'm not an expert at this. You guys are the experts. I'm just the guy on the street that, if I was hearing this, would be thinking that this is a little bit unreasonable.
Those are good questions. A couple of points. One is that drowning your lawn one day a week is better for your lawn to start with.
Right. Well, I don't care about the. I'm talking more about the water.
Is it? Right. The second thing is, what happens when everybody does it every day? Is that there's something called the sprinkler notch in our hourly chart of what's going on in the tank. The way we run our system is we run the wells all the time. We run the water treatment plant at the speed necessary to keep the height of water in the standpipes tall enough to maintain pressure to households and fire hydrants. At 4 a.m., he could set his watch by when all of a sudden the tank goes like this because everybody turns on their sprinkler system. So then all day long, we are cranking like crazy to try to get that tank back up again to where we can provide adequate pressure to households and to fire hydrants. Simply spreading out that usage over 7 days eliminates that problem that we put our community in. And it's a problem it's really driven. A lot of this comes from conservation, but it also comes to me out of the water department, the water treatment, the ability to supply water, which is a very important thing.
But just for that one point, that one point, you know, that's where education may come into place. If you said, okay, you know, let's try and get some sort of staggering system where you guys do it at midnight, you guys started at 2, you guys started at 4, 6, and 8, and maybe try and not take the drain.
We're trying to say you guys started on Monday, you guys started on Tuesday, you guys started on Wednesday. That's simpler for us to communicate to our patrons. We think it's reasonable in terms of good lawn management, and it also serves conservation needs, and it helps protect our supply pressure. And John, if you could, has been involved in the background from the. I guess lawn care industry, as well as now working with the state of the DEP, and knows a lot what other communities are doing and what seems to have worked and not worked.
Before my recent transformation to working in the environmental area, I actually owned a lawn care company centered here in Scituate, and we tried to educate our customers as best we could that good heavy soakings was better than frequent light waterings. So the one day a week does play into better lawn management for the turf, and lawn care companies speak of it as often as they can. Although this plays favorably towards a water conservation policy, I go back to what Al's trying to get across, that it's really a public safety policy. By taking those high spikes in water usage and dividing it across 6 days, you're improving the ability of the water pressure to deliver water to all the households and to the fire department in the event of a community emergency.
No, I agree, and I you know, that my point would be, again, education. Do people know that they should be only, you know,
right.
You know, if we put this policy in place, it's
right.
You know, it's done. You know, where I'm thinking, if you took steps to say, here, people, here's what you should do, and try and do this before you get to that point, seems to be more of an easing of
education is always a preferred, but when you start to talk about staggering the hours across a day, you do have to finally recognize the tipping point of the viability of the enforcement. And the viability of enforcement of a clock system as you're suggesting. I'm not sure who's going to be out there between 12 and 2 a.m. to see if the right neighborhood is watering. But if you do it on a daily system, the enforcement is a manageable system.
Right. Well, even if you say to people, look, if we don't see some sort of improvement, then this is going to be the next step.
But this is that first step to be taken to try to avoid in August the entire ban. You know, we can't guarantee there won't be a full ban as there was last summer, but it is an attempt to, if we are successful with this, we hopefully will be able to avoid it.
Do you know if there was a full ban the prior year?
Yeah, there was a full ban. In fact, that full ban lasted until January.
Last year.
And the full ban this year right. was instituted in August, but wasn't lifted until November. It took that long for the system to recover. So that means that during all those periods, no one was washing cars, watering anything other than a vegetable garden, no outside use of anything.
I think it's important to make the point here that we're talking about a much smaller segment of the town, because we're talking about just those in-ground irrigation systems. We're not talking about all watering. That's a big difference. So we're talking about potentially 200, maybe 250 families here, rather than 7,500 families.
And you're confident that it's due to the irrigation systems?
That we know that is that that Jim's staff has been out and about, and we do know which houses have got are using the most water. And when you drive past those houses, you go to look at those houses, the irrigation systems are running with the little pop-ups.
Mr. Norton?
If this was to be implemented tonight, in the way you presented it, could we not, a year from now, could you not come back with figures similar to this chart here, showing whether it works or not?
Yes.
Or how much it works? Is it 100% successful? Is it 20% successful? Was it worth it? Did we get a lot of negative feedback? And that would be my thought, that you be prepared in what reasons to come back.
Huh? Are you excited to get, I can tell you're going to get feedback, I'll tell you that. 275 of them in about an hour.
Well, you might also get 6,800 homeowners who don't have water sprinklers saying, I get a good water flow now, you know? We're talking really about 200 people, of which I am one also, versus whatever it is, 6,800 non-lawn sprinkler people who hopefully will benefit by this.
Yes.
I guess what I'm asking is to go back next year and let's see if they really did benefit and see how much. I mean, if there were 200 brown lawns all over town and people were screaming, I would have to take another look at it.
I will also point out with my lawn care experience that a brown lawn is a dormant lawn, not a dead lawn.
Sean?
Thank you for that useful bit of information.
One positive thing, Tony, you can say to these people. All right, first of all, before I forget, so if I have an irrigation system and I don't have a well, I can drill my own well and I can water as much or as little as I want this summer.
And okay. Also,
there's one alternative.
Also, if you have an irrigation system, you can still, any day you want to, wash your car, use a hose
right.
to water your gardens or to chase your child around the yard with or whatever.
Right.
Yes.
And one other thing.
Sorry, yes, sir.
There'd be another benefit to this that we can say to those 250 people, because I remember Gene coming before us. How many phone calls did we get, Joe, with the brown water, and we watched Al drink it? Now, if I'm not mistaken, if those water levels stay up and the pressure stays up and we're not having to replenish the standpipes as often, right, Jimmy? Then the water quality will get better.
Should yes,
get
better.
Really. You won't have to drink any brown water.
These are all things that we will have to test.
Can we hang our hat on that?
Yeah.
That's a possibility. We'll find out.
We'll find out, yes.
I would have to say that I initially, when reviewing this, thought maybe the once a week was a draconian measure. However, I will say that I don't have an irrigation system, and I know that a lot of people in August and September were complaining about when is the ban going to be lifted. because they couldn't do it. And of course, you're right. I remember 2 years ago, it wasn't until the winter, and then last year also wasn't until the late fall when we had a whole bunch of rain. I think what surprises me the most is that there's approximately 200 to 300 users that really exacerbate or put more they take more from the system.
They drive the system.
What's that?
They drive us to.
And I think that's probably in the light of that, that's to me enough to be able to say maybe we should try to implement for just this year alone, a policy to see if it actually works. And if it looks like things are going fine, and maybe we can be more less restrictive and maybe altering that. If I think the concern I have too is, and I don't know if you have the answer, is that at what point with the millions of gallons from 2006 until 2010 does the reservoir get completely drained? Is it at somewhere around 60,000 or 60 million to 70, or I don't know when, but I mean at some point it'd be interesting to see, especially if these restrictions are put in play, whether or not, now again, that's also a factor of whether it rains and you get more rain in, but if you don't, you might be able to measure that a little more consistently from the past 2 years.
Right, and again, I kind of like where this is going, because again, on behalf of the Water Resource Committee, you guys know, you know how we're working, and we our intention is going to be that this becomes part of a much bigger plan. So as we learn, as we get the information next year, we'll factor that in when we come back with the water conservation plan. Because by the way, the conservation, I mean, one of the messages that the town needs to understand, and I would ask the citizens watching tonight to understand that conservation is just like digging another new well. It's like buying a piece of property and doing all the exploration that we have to do to make up another source. If we can find 200,000 or 300,000 gallons a day through conservation, that will save the town many hundreds, maybe millions of dollars in developing new sources. So that's a good thing for the town. As we're going through such tight financial times right now, this would be a very good thing for the whole town if we can find a new well by conserving what we've already got.
I guess I'm confused as to why we're taking such a huge leap from where we are to way over there instead of trying to find someplace in the middle to see if that's going to solve it before we go to such an extreme policy here. I mean, we've been around for 375 years and we've never had to go to anything this extreme. Granted, we've had bans, not every year, 2 out of 3, as Al pointed out. I don't know historically behind that, but it seems like there's got to be a stepping stone to where we want to get, if we even need to get that far. The other thing is, you know, these people pay for that water. You know, it's a tiered system. So when you get above a certain, you're paying a premium for that water. I would imagine this is going to have a huge impact on the revenue of the enterprise fund as well. It seems to me that if we're going to go to something this level, we should gradually get to that point instead of jumping off the cliff to get to something that I don't think you could implement a policy that would be stricter than this. Again, you could implement a ban that could be stricter than this, but I think it would be crazy for us to implement a policy where you could water your lawn once a month or something like that.
Well, the next level that we might, if we needed something more draconian than this, would be that it's not just for the in-ground irrigation systems, but it's for everybody. That would be much more restrictive, and that would be impacting a much larger population in the town. So I think that there are other steps that we could take. We believe that this, first of all, this is something that's being done towns throughout Massachusetts now. So Scituate would not be unique in coming up with this kind of a plan. And John could tell us more about that because of the work he does in the state. But I do think that it could get much more draconian than this. And again, it may be then that we come back to you as the water commissioners and say, okay, we really need to find another source within the next 5 years and get it online. You haven't heard that from us. I mean, what we've been saying thus far is we need to find additional sources as we move forward, not that we need it online immediately. Because that could be, as you know, it could be a large expense. So I realize that this seems like we're leaping way to the other side, but I think that what we really are proposing is exactly what you're saying, is a small step forward. This is not the sum total of what we could do for conservation in town.
I guess I don't see it as crazy in light of what you've presented tonight. I initially thought it was draconian, but I've kind of gotten to the point where if there's 200 users who are actually are driving over 40, or call it, you know, 20 million gallons or 30 million gallons conservatively.
200,000 a day.
You know, that's a lot by comparison to the other. You're right, they pay for it, but I think the larger demographics pay for it, given that if there's a water restriction in place, everybody else is going to be now stuck having to not use water for August, September, October. That's been demonstrated for the past 2 years, and I think the past 2 years have kind of demonstrated that we do need to implement something a little bit more stricter, and that's why I'm looking at it saying, I think the other concern is this: if people are concerned about having their lawns damaged, at least you're telling me the best management practices for facilities are to say one large soaking for 6 days or 7 days a week. If that is acceptable, and I'm trusting you that is exactly it, then I could see that, okay, then their lawns will not be damaged. I mean, let's face it, everybody's lawn burns in August.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the reality of it,
well,
and then it grows back again. It's just, that's been the way it always has been. But I just think, looking at it now, I'm like, I think you've made sense, in my opinion. That's why I say, Tony, I'm willing to take that step. If it turns out it's not worth it, then we can address it again next year and then revisit it and change it. I just think the restrictions that in and of themselves for the remaining 6,800 demonstrate that, yeah, we should take a deeper step trying to restrict it.
Don't you think like an odd even day thing or something would be a gradual motion move towards that as opposed to 1 day a week?
But I think,
I mean, isn't the first ban to just stop irrigated systems anyways?
Don't forget there's another factor in here, which is rain. It actually rains, okay? It started that irrigation systems were to supplement, and then they became the drug, okay? And people, their irrigation systems are set to run every day. The lawn doesn't need that much water. The water department wasn't founded to provide potable water to be dumped on lawns. It was founded to be providing the two purposes I've talked about before. Somehow, in the course of time, it slipped in that if you have water on your property from the town, you can use it however you want to. And I think some of our customers will thank us, because those same customers were the ones in very exercised over the size of the water bill they got last summer, because they were watering every day, and gee, there's a ban on, how can my bill be so high? Well, you were watering every day.
See, I don't have an irrigation system, so I don't have a horse in the race, and I think that this is, you know, an extreme and just over use of government is my thought. I mean, I've said my opinion, so.
Mr. Chairman, we've had good discussion on this, I think, and good arguments of both sides of the issue, but I wonder if you would accept a motion.
Sure, please.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to implement the changes in the water policy per the recommendations made in the memorandum dated March 22, 2011 from the Department of Public Works, and ask the Department of Public Works to return a year from today with the results of this new procedure.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Further discussion. I didn't ask anybody in the audience. Was there any questions in the audience before we go further? Ms. Burbine.
Yes, the answer is that will be part of our considerations. We will likely be recommending that all irrigation systems be permitted and that they all require moisture sensors so that we will not have irrigation during rain. So we are working along those lines.
And I will say that I do agree with Mr. Banger on this issue. I want water when I turn on the tap, and we should be very grateful.
Thank you. Any other questions? This gentleman here. If you could give
Bill Branton, Strawberry Lane.
Thank you.
Do we presently manage like our ball fields this way?
We are going to.
Well, what my point was, if we did that would be a case in point, that if Green Bush looks green and it's doing it on just a Tuesday watering, it's proof that your lawn will also do the same. And I also agree with Mr. Banger. I have one more comment that's related to clean water that I would like the board to address if they could.
That's out of order if I think what it is, Mr. Branton. If we're talking about discs, it's not germane to this discussion, okay?
When could that be?
We had a walk-in period earlier, which would have been the ideal situation. But I'll tell you what, we could, I'd have to say it would be our next walk-in next week, would be the period, which would be Tuesday, okay? So I'd like to move on to, yes?
Jean Childen, 143 Tilden Road. Just wanted to reiterate what you said, Mr. Chairman, that I don't think it's appropriate to label this proposal as draconian or extreme if the intent is to move toward best practice for lawn care. That doesn't make sense to me. It's not just a conservation measure. It's not a punishment. It will teach people how to take care of their lawns in the best possible way. And I don't think people are willing to learn that unless they're forced to.
So we're going to force people how to treat their lawn.
Okay, so any other questions? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And against?
Aye.
One against. Gentlemen, thank you very much. Appreciate for the hard work. Moving on to the next discussion, which is assignment of articles for 2011, the annual town meeting and the special town meeting. And I'm pleased to announce that I think our missing selectman has offered some of these items.
I thought he offered to do all of them, no?
I thought he was going to handle all of the budgetary items. I'm happy to give it to him.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I think historically you take the special and everything through the operating budget.
Yes.
And then anything after that you might like, but I think historically that's...
That means I take 1 through 4 the special and 1 through 5.
Is that what it
Does
is?
Anybody have any hard feelings on that?
None whatsoever.
Okay. Then why don't I do this? Rick Murray had requested articles. I'm just going to jump, and if anybody want to jump in and take them, fine. Then we'll go back to the right. Rick would like to take Article 9, Waterway Enterprise Fund.
Sean, didn't you want to do that?
So Rick's going to get to the Article 9. Kim, is that all right?
That's fine.
And then we've got Article 17, which is the community preservation. Rick would be willing to do those.
He's the liaison there.
Article 18, which is the CPA reconciliation, Community Preservation Act reconciliations. He's also the liaison there. Article 26, which is Musquashka Pond Restoration Petition, which is a private petition, which is 26. And also Article 27, which is Musquashka Pond Restoration. It's a part two. And he was looking to take those. So
I'll take the water. I'll take the enterprise funds unless somebody else wants them.
The enterprise fund. So you're looking to take the Article 9.
I'm just thinking
10.
Whoever does 9.
Can I do 6, 7, 8?
Well, Murray has 9.
Oh, Murray has 9.
Murray
so we'll
has
cross
9. Okay.
So you're looking to take 10, 11, 12, 13, which is Article 13. So those are as follows: the golf course enterprise fund, wastewater enterprise fund, transfer station enterprise fund, and also the water enterprise fund. That would be
and
Joe.
And Mr. Murray has the water...
Waterways enterprise fund.
Waterways, okay. Mr. Murray.
I'll do 6, 7, 8 if you want.
And Tony's going to take Article 6, which is the contingent appropriations fiscal year 2012 operating budget. Article 7, which is the establishment of other post-employment benefit trust fund. And Article 8, which is the funding for other post-employment benefits liability trust.
Want me to do 14, 15, 16? I mean...
I was going to say, who's absent here? No. What would you like, Sean? 14, 15,
it doesn't
16?
Matter what I take, but I'll take those three.
Okay. Yeah, it makes sense. So, Sean, you'll take Article 14, which is the stabilization fund.
Mm-hmm.
Article 15, which is the assessor's reevaluation. and Article 16, which is Mass General Laws, Chapter 91, liability.
Mm-hmm, sure.
Now, that leaves us with Articles, Acceptance of Schematic Design, Article 19.
I'll do that if you want, to you guys, unless someone else wants to.
Bear with me here.
Rick, Mary on Hollis Street, is he involved in that?
I'll do 20, 21, 22 if you want.
20, 21, 22, okay.
And I'm done.
I think the chairman, you're on the...
I'm going to take the street acceptance. I'll take those. So...
So is that 23, 24?
I will take 23, 24, 25.
Rick's got 26 and 27. I'll do 28.
And I'll finish off with 29 and 30.
So the only, 19 is Sean, right?
Yes.
Acceptance of Schematic Design of Library.
Unless you want it, Tony.
No, I just want to make sure I...
Yeah, okay.
Have mine down.
If not, I'll do it, Sean, because I'm up for the next... Oh, no, who's got 20? Yeah, either way, that's fine. All right, so did we... Kim, let's go back over that. Do you have them all, or...
Do you want me to read?
You can if you want. If you got them, though, then that's fine. We don't need to. I mean, you're all set. All right. Well, great. That went quick. That's it for our agenda item number 10, which brings us to agenda item number 11, which is a discussion.
Right back.
Cole Parkway, parking spaces, overnight parking, and green space. This was an item that I asked to call for the board. And the reason for it was... just get to your items. Obviously, you know, the Board of Selectmen control the use of Cole Parkway. And after having been down to Cole Parkway on numerous occasions for various reasons, I began to think, you know, Cole Parkway, it's a great destination. It's a great opportunity for the town to maximize. It has a lot of potential for better green space than presently exists. There have been different plans and proposals in the course of the past number of years. Right away, I go back to 2000, 2001, there was a design charrette from the planning board about how to improve access to the back end of the land, or Cole Parkway, from Front Street. And in particular, you go to Cole Parkway, and I know whether you're going to take a look at the boats or look at the views or the vistas, listen to the band or bands, it's kind of, not kind of, it is, it's in a deplorable state. It needs to be improved. But unfortunately, given the economics, it's very hard for us to say, well, let's fix it, let's do this, let's do that. So in the mind and spirit of trying to figure out how to generate revenue, one of the things that I noticed is that there tends to be a lot of vehicles that are parked and not parked for the purposes of the business or purposes of looking out over the views, but parked overnight, parked long-term. So consequently, I was thinking if there's a possibility for the board to think about generating money to maybe either... thinking long-term to fix, to expand, and of course, presently we have a harbor walk that's being constructed or looks to be constructed from Front Street going down to what's known as the Fisherman's Landing or Russo's Landing. And ultimately, we have a gap between the Harbor Master's building and where Russo's Landing is, and that's where the green space is, or what tends to have a lot of dog remnants. And the band show. So my thought was, is there a possibility for us to maybe take a look at this long term, maybe put together a committee of people who want to take a look at this and then come back to the board, but with a mind of trying to implement parking, overnight parking, and charging for that on a monthly basis to generate some revenue to maybe fix up that area. So if people are living in the downtown area and they don't have parking, then they can pay the town to park overnight in a certain designated area. This, obviously, we don't want to impact the businesses because we want to promote parking for public down there. And maybe also try to encourage the workers who work down there not to park in the choice locations in front of the stores. The other area I was thinking was whether or not, pursuant to the charrette that was put forward by the planning board, of trying to reconfigure it so that you could put more of a green space. And I'm pointing to the board over here because that's the actual plan of the parking of Cole Parkway around the bandstand and trying to expand that space towards CVS and the buildings with the option of lowering gates or lowering chains or ropes so that in the event you needed overflow parking, you could park there. But that would give you some more green space. Simultaneously, I'd also spoken with Bill Limbach, the chairman of the planning board, and I was hoping to approach the planning board and meet with them before coming here tonight, but I'm on the agenda for another night. The town also owns land behind the Bank of America, located on Edward Foster's Road, across from the baseball field at St. Mary's. And one of the thoughts was, if we were to diminish or reduce some of the parking on Cole Parkway, trying to augment the green space, we could also take some of that parking and have it as overflow or picnic parking off of Cole, off of Edward Foster, so that in the event that you needed excess parking, it's just around literally the corner. And again, that was one of the thoughts I had. I thought I'd bring it to the board for discussion, see if the board's interested. If they are, great, maybe we could put together a committee. I'd represent this to the planning board. If the board is not, that's fine too. But one of the things I think we as a board should do is that people are parking in Cole Parkway overnight, using it for parking when they shouldn't be, because it's public parking, and we should if they're going to do that, then we should charge them and give them a monthly pass, and then you know, use that money to benefit Cole Parkway and make various improvements. So that's what I asked Kim to put in your packets. You'll notice what I put there was the basically a area or location behind the Bank of America, which is on Edward Foster Road, which goes out. It is not necessarily restricted by conservation. It is uplands. There is potential tidal problems, I think, with the water. But, you know, this is something that I know that the planning board has looked at but hasn't really moved on it, and thought maybe we could take a look at utilizing this area in the future. With some gravel and some parking. I think Bill had mentioned some maybe potential picnicking, so you get the view of looking out over. And so that's why I brought it to the board.
What parcels, all three? Are these all ours?
The parcel that we have is...
this one, and this one?
I'm not sure if it's the 15,000 feet. I assume it is. I may be wrong, but I...
So 5-plus acres,
but almost. You're looking at definitely the 5-plus acres. Actually,
a lot of this has got to be wet.
It is, actually.
Or it certainly abuts. Well, that'd be great, but I'd be surprised we could do anything there, John.
You know, I think that's a question that we need to ask.
Right,
and say,
right. Definitely asking. It doesn't hurt to ask, right?
You'd then say to yourself, you've got some off site parking that you could, you know, my view is, look, maximize for benefit of the town space that's on the water as green space, instead of having an impervious asphalt. And then if you have overflow parking, you can put it over to this location, which really is not that far to walk. You know?
No. Is there a sidewalk that I know there is in front of Bank of America, so I mean, it'd be great.
It goes all the way down to Peggy on the other side. But I guess ConCon would have to look at it, because I wonder how much of this, if you take this down, if there would be flooding in the tide change.
Right.
That land was given to us, I remember discussing years ago on it, and how much of it was underwater, or how much was high, I just forget.
By a private developer.
But I think what John's talking about, even if you just took this, you know, you don't have to come way down here.
Right.
Even if you took that area there, you could put a fair amount of...
Yeah, I think that's high ground there, too, I think.
Well, the bank's on the other side.
The other thing I this has been a pet peeve of mine, and maybe there's no way of dealing, but the storage of the floats, you know, of the docks drives me crazy down there. I mean, I just say to myself, we've got to find another location. It's, you know, for access. Granted, during the winter, January, February, maybe not a lot of people don't go down there, but, you know, for the most rest of the year, for the 10 months, a lot of people go down there. And I'm like, there's got to be a better location for it. But that was the other issue I wanted to out there.
I missed the first 5 minutes this year, but would there be any, we can discuss it here tonight, if we don't do anything as a result of this, it's going to die.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
I wonder if we shouldn't, would we want to think about some sort of a group that would look at the whole area down there and come back with recommendations? Oh, no recommendations. How would we implement anything unless...
I was proposing just that. I was proposing putting a... basically, I say committee, of just some people to get together to look at various issues. I was going to also present in front of the planning board, because I'd spoken with Bill Lombardo, the chairman. And, you know, obviously, the concern is not to just diminish parking altogether, but also to have the relief valve of placing it somewhere else, which could be on Edward Foster. And the other concept was that in the event that you could cordon off a section of the parking lot, so that in the event that you needed that overflow parking, you could drop chains or drop ropes so that you could park into that area. But try to augment the area and make beautify it, make it more green and for long term. And that was what, and my thought was maybe we put together a committee to take a look at this and then come back to the board with potential suggestions.
And I'm also thinking that part of the problem was brought up earlier, and maybe you mentioned this when I was out also, that a good deal of that parking that results in shortage of parking places is brought on by employees in the store who don't want to walk too far either, and they park as close as they possibly can to their place of employment. So you've got, again, I have no idea how many people work in Front Street, but most of them that do park their cars as close to Front Street as they can, resulting in probably 100 parking places.
Right. I was thinking that was another, suggesting the same, that maybe try to designate certain areas during the business day that if you're an employee, this is the area that you should park so that you keep spaces closer to the building for the customers or patrons so that they have the access.
It's to the store owners and the employees' own benefit to do that, because if people can't get in close to the stores, they may end up at the Hanover Mall. You know, you try to make it as accessible as possible. So maybe this group, whatever this group is, could look at that also.
It'd be great if you could get a bridge or something that goes over the...
Well, I wasn't going to raise it tonight, but I was going to say, you know, we talked about the bridge at some other location. I'm like, ideally, long-term, it would be nice to put a bridge from Cole Parkway if we could financially do it in the future, years from now, connecting that area over Scituate Brook. I mean, a lot of people don't realize that's where the town gets its name, Scituate Brook, and we just drive over it most of the time. But here you'd have a parking area, or as Bill said, a picnic area. You could see this is the brook where the town got its name. Big wow. But better yet, you got a beautiful view and you'd have that. It would be much more conducive for the harbor walk, and then connecting it potentially to Edward Foster, which connects you to the Marine Center. So long-term view would be nice.
It's a great idea, but I think that's a huge conservation issue, going over a brook or a river or something. I think that's huge. I think it's a lot of obstacles. You know, whether there should be or not is another question, but I think I remember somewhere where it was attempted and it was just almost a lost cause because of the conservation restrictions. But certainly look at it.
All I was hoping to say to the board, if they're interested, then I put together a charge and try to present to the planning board to make sure that they're also in
agreement.
And I threw that out there for your benefit.
Good
what
idea.
Your thoughts were. Is that a
sounds great, John.
Sounds great.
Do I need a motion for that at all? Or?
I don't think so.
No? Good. Good. Gentlemen, thank you. All right. Moving on to the next agenda item, which is the acceptance of resignation from the Board of Registrars.
Motion, Mr. Chairman?
Please.
Move the Board of Selectmen accept the resignation of Alma Morrison from the Board of Registrars, and further that the Board thank Mrs. Morrison for her years of service to the town of Scituate.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous. And moving on to agenda item number 13, which is the appointments, Sister City Committee, and also a cable television committee.
Move that the Board of Selectmen appoint the following individuals to the Sister City Committee: Virginia Hayes, David Noonan Jr., Beth Murat, and Pascal Murat.
Second.
Also, Nicole. That's all right.
And also, you can say that one. No, Nicole Kramer.
Second by Mr. Harris?
Yes.
Or Mr. Norton?
Either one.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Next one, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, if you could, Mr. Norton.
Move that the Board of Selectmen appoint Kathy Bullock as an associate member of the Cable Television Committee.
Second. Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. All in favor?
Aye.
That's a three.
I'm going to abstain from that one.
Nothing vote.
She's my sister-in-law.
And the final one.
Move the Board of Selectmen appoint Virginia Heffernan to the 375th Anniversary Celebration Committee.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Discussion? Seeing none? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous. Moving on to agenda item number 14, the storm update. And in that case, I'm going to turn it over to our town administrator. Tricia, good evening.
I think at the board's last meeting, which I was not in attendance, Mr. Norton mentioned that the town had received notification that we would not be, the county and the Commonwealth had not met the thresholds for any reimbursement for the storm damage December 26th and 27th. I don't think that was surprising to the community. I think we were unique among only a few handful of other towns that sustained a lot of damage, but nevertheless, the $4 million that we submitted will not materialize. So given that, and the fact that our town meeting is peppered with various warrant articles to sort of fund the various costs that we've incurred, both long-term and short-term, I drafted some letters to the town's representatives to ask for their support for state funding to reimburse the community. I did some preliminary research and had some discussions with other colleagues in other communities. I think there certainly is precedent for the town to make this request. I think even though it's difficult times, as we know, for the legislature and the state, as well as localities, this is not something that was caused by the town, something we could not have prevented. And I think the next step in this process is to ask our elected representatives to do everything they possibly can to help assist us in trying to get some cost reimbursements for this incident.
Would that be, if I may, Mr. Chairman, would that be like a home rule petition to fund it, give us somehow?
I mean, there's various options. It wouldn't be locally here, but we would ask them to file a supplemental legislation on our behalf to appropriate funds for various costs that we incurred.
Has there been a precedent for that? Has that happened before in other towns?
Yes.
It has.
Damn this.
Well, we have, I certainly don't suggest we shouldn't do that. Obviously, if we're able to get some form of funding from the state in light of the disaster, why wouldn't we do it?
Well, I believe it's a matter of fairness and equity. Yeah. And that's what our elected representatives are in the State House for. And I would also ask the board's permission to also send a letter to the governor asking that we've asked our representatives to do that. I do not think we're to the stage where we have not left any stone unturned yet in trying to get some assistance from this storm. And in fact, you know, once we get the additional appropriations in town meeting, we're still going to be trying to get back to where we were December 26th for a long, long time.
And also, you state in your letters here where there's been other instances where other towns have gotten money for other catastrophes that they've had. So this isn't us going out of line in terms of, you know, a financial request from the state.
Right. And I also included in the draft the whole issue with National Grid and the investigation that's going on there. And if any fines are levied, those are going to go to the Commonwealth, even though we experienced the drama.
Tony, you didn't think to mention it to Kerry when he was here a couple weeks ago, did you?
We had lunch the other day.
Although, I thank you very much, Tricia. Yeah. Those are...
We talked to Keating about this at the St. Patrick's Day Parade as well and asked him, you know, to look on our behalf to see if there was anything that he could help us out with. We get a lot of nods, but not a lot of confidence, so...
Well, I think folks were just waiting to see what would flush out with the FEMA MEMA stuff. Mm. That's happened now, so now we're to the next phase.
Should we be asking the same of our federal representatives in any way?
Well, it's my understanding the federal involvement really is only through the FEMA, through the disaster area. There are more federally, nationally based organizations related to the whole coastal seawall issue, but in terms of direct funding or whatever, and something imminent. those I have not been made aware of and haven't been provided to us by our federal.
Okay. Good. Well, any other questions? Yes.
Plastic waste from this storm 2 weeks ago is on the beach now and can be washed back up by the next high tide. And the next expedition cleanup will be called for. It will be paid for by an outside town.
Mr. Brand, I appreciate.
Waiting till next week is a bit too late because then it'll be redistributed.
Mr. Brand, you need to understand the procedure of open meeting. Mr. Brand, please, excuse me, we can't talk over each other, okay? Hold on 1 second. The opportunity to speak about an issue outside of the agenda, we give people that opportunity in the walk-in. We only are allowed 5 minutes, and we can't have a discussion on it because of the change of the open meeting laws. That's why I said to you, the next time we as a board constituted three or more can discuss it with you openly, is in open meeting that we have to post, give people fair notice of what we're going to talk about, and then have a meeting on it. The discussion that we're talking about is not about what you want to talk about, which I know you want to talk about, which we can talk about next Tuesday, and I realize there's a sense of urgency on your part, but I can't get into that because I'm in violation of state statute, which we can't do, which is a violation of the open meeting law of discussing something that wasn't posted and giving fair notice to everybody else. So I'm not trying to be short with you, but I'm just trying to tell you, we can't talk about it, okay?
Like
I'm happy to talk to you outside, personally.
But
that's a separate storm. We're talking about the storm from December 26th, 27th. And that's been posted. That's why we're talking about the storm update of it. But I'll be happy to talk to you outside about it, okay, after our meeting. But three of us cannot, okay, because that would be a violation. You can talk to us individually, separately, we can't do it collectively, okay? And I told you I'd be happy to next Tuesday we can address it. Moving on to
Town Administrator's Report.
Town Administrator's Report, agenda number 915. Hold on for 1 second. We can at least acknowledge in other business the subject you're talking about, but we can't get into a discussion. How's that, okay? All right, so we're going to get to that in two more agenda items. Actually, the next one. All right? Tricia, 15.
I've included the financial trend monitoring through January 31st. Mary's working on February and March, but you hadn't seen it for a while. And since it was the midpoint of the fiscal year, I wanted to just make sure I included and also highlighted some narrative relative to the expenditures. I think the change in fuel prices is something that's going to affect us for the latter part of the fiscal year that we were doing pretty well on. Fire overtime, as you know, this continues to be a challenge, and we're funding it not only at this special town meeting and the override, but it's just a combination of many things, and I included that study for you for us to schedule after town meeting.
Can I ask you, I know you talk about fuel cost, and can the town trying to conserve, just try to throw through the department heads to make sure that all the employees turn off their vehicles? I'm sure they do. But I know some of them don't for reasons to keep the mechanics going. But I'm like, sometimes I think at this point, you know what? Because the gas prices are, they're almost $4 a gallon. And I'm like, you know, I'm just saying that is there a way to make sure that at this point, turn the keys off, the ignitions off?
Yes, this
health and safety
is part of
what I'm thinking of that you generally say.
Green communities that we are, there's an anti-idling policy that we have to look at. I just actually signed a contract last week with Al to do a monitoring system on the gas pumps for utilization. And the third thing is if we could ever replace some of the vehicles that we have as part of our green communities, we should be replacing them with hybrids or fuel-efficient vehicles. But that is something that, you know, I think we have to be more mindful of, and I'll follow up with Al. But
Didn't we already vote on that?
Yes, yeah. We had to as part of the overall.
Right.
But I'd asked that in the past, and I'm not trying to pick on one department over the other, but I'm thinking, you know what, it might make sense just to turn the car off.
Yeah, and I think we can always do more and re-educate people to be mindful of that. So back to the revenue and expense, our tax collections are holding steady, which is really good. Veterans, Mary informed me today, has a $14,000 shortfall that she's protecting through June 30th. I had mentioned that later in the narrative as well, and she just happened to look at it today. Free cash for snow and ice removal, if it doesn't snow again, is up to, what is it, Mary? $44,000 out of free cash. So we want to preserve as much as the free cash as we can.
Is that more than what we budgeted for?
That's your deficit.
That's not bad, considering the snowfall that we had.
Yes, I think comparative to other communities that I might have read in the paper, we're doing okay, but it's still money out of free cash, which we don't like to take. So overall, no alarming concerns other than the one I already mentioned about fuel and veterans, again, we had talked about, and fire over time. And then most of the stuff that I have in the narrative for FY12 is just a summary of stuff, since you've already approved and gone through the warrant, is well known to you, and I did a supplemental email information for the board this evening about where the House Ways and Means budget might be shaping up based on a message that I had from Representative Cantwell. I will probably speak with greater specificity next Tuesday night on the budget, because the health insurance budget's being voted Friday by the county. We'll be at the end of another month for things like the unemployment bill, which I think we might have some options, but as has always been the case now for the last 7 years, we're not getting a local aid number from the legislature till sometimes after the beginning of the fiscal year. And it's like trying to hit a moving target as far as what that number actually might be. And we don't know if we're right on the money or halfway there or whatever. So I think we still have to be a little cautious. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Questions from the board?
I don't know.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. That brings us to agenda item number 16, other business.
You want me to go first?
Why don't you go first?
Sure. Just a couple quick things, kind of piggybacking on what Tricia just said. We're having a financial forecasting meeting coming up next Tuesday. To go over some of the stuff that she talked about there. Again, we don't foresee any major changes, but we will be preparing the document for the annual town meeting. So that's going on there. One other thing I just want to take a second to talk about, because I've been getting a lot of questions on the street in terms of the override that has been put before the town. There's a little bit of confusion about the repairs for seawall and what the override for the town side is going to be utilized for. First of all, we did pass in the capital plan for 2012 $500,000 for seawall repair. So that is in the capital plan that will be before everybody for at the annual town meeting. That's one component. The second component is part of the $2.2 million override. There's about $523,000 worth of capital items in that, which the board agreed would be used moving forward to fund infrastructure needs, seawalls, roads, buildings, that sort of stuff. In this year that we're talking about now, I think there's $400,000 that would be earmarked towards road seawall type issues, and you know, $100,000 towards building issues in the first fiscal year, and then I would imagine every year moving forward, that would come before the board to see how we want to spend that portion going forward in terms of what the needs of the town were. So just so people understand, capital plan has seawall money in it, override has seawall road money in it, and they are two different components, but two components fighting the same infrastructure problem that we have. And lastly, just wanted to thank all the people from the parade. Great time. The event was very well attended. The weather cooperated, and everybody had a real good fun. It was a long parade and a lot of good bands and whatnot, so it was a good event. So thank you for all the people that did that.
Thank you. All right, Mr. Brandt, right?
Yes.
I just want to address the issue under other business, although you're welcome to come back next Tuesday and we can discuss it a little while and talk about it. So everybody might be wondering, what am I talking about here? Evidently, I'm not sure how far back this was, like a month ago or so, in the town of Hooksett, New Hampshire, their wastewater treatment facility ended up overflowing, whether it was due to the storms or the floods, you know. Suffice it to say that as a result of the facility overflowing, different items ended up overflowing into the river and consequently found its way to the ocean, and due to the current, these items ended up coming south towards the North Shore, and now are here on the South Shore, and in particular, Scituate. What are these items? Well, these items happen to be these discs, approximately about 2 inches long. I believe they're plastic discs. And the town of Hooksett, New Hampshire, is going to be paying. It's going to cost them somewhere in the realm of $8 million. And there's a company, the name of the company is escaping me off the top of my head, but has been hired to go and start collecting these things. If people, and I hope people do, are willing to put on gloves and collect these and put them in bags around our beaches and our shores, it would be greatly appreciated. Mr. Brandt is one individual who's been leading the charge, trying to encourage people to do just that. So if you're on the beach, you're walking around the beach, if you're walking around anywhere on the coastal line, you're going to begin to see these things. Unfortunately, once you pick them up, the tide's going to probably bring more back in and take some more out, and it's going to keep going until these items are ultimately picked up and gleaned. So it is a mess, frankly. It's certainly an environmental situation that needs to be picked up. It's certainly not like oil or you know, gases or real hazardous waste, but there are items that are certainly biodegradable that need to be picked up. And so I certainly would say, for people who live around who want to try to help out, if you do, put on gloves and start putting these in bags. And I guess I'm not sure whether, I mean, you could certainly dispose them at the transfer station. I suppose we could call the Department of Public Works. We could arrange something to be picked up without having to pay for them. And certainly the company that's going to be charged with cleaning it up is coming to Scituate. They're not here today. They were here this past weekend assessing the situation. If you're down on Peggotty, they're in Peggotty. I believe they're down in Egypt Beach, which is where it's really impacted, Minot. So all these other beaches are going to be impacted. So for those people, you know, that's what we're talking about. And obviously it's a mess. The town has assessed it. They're trying to figure out, you know, when we can get the private company to come to start picking it up. So,
but just, and maybe Trisha, you know better, it's part of a filtration system, isn't it? So it's not toxic, it's not poisonous, it's a little plastic thing that filtered probably some sort of waste or some sort. So don't pick it up, don't put it in your mouth, but you know, it's not something that's going to kill you if you pick it up, but it is dirty.
So that's the first item. The second item was to tell that the Town Advisory Committee has put together its annual and special town meeting report and recommendations. You can pick up a copy here at Town Hall, or better yet, go to the town website, download it, or take a look at it and save it and save paper. But the Advisory Committee has put it out for the annual and special town meeting, which is coming up on April 11th. And so I encourage all to take a look at it and be better prepared for the town meeting. And finally,
can I correct some information you gave?
No, you cannot. I'm sorry, Mr. Brandt. The final thing I wanted to address is a personal note. The boys basketball, this really should come under Tony's purview of the sports update, but the boys basketball travel team for the town of Scituate won its championship. It was undefeated. It did a superb job. The coaches were Kevin Grant and also Sean Sullivan, and all the boys on the team did a phenomenal job. They were undefeated.
What grade? Fourth grade?
Fourth grade. And they won their championship, one of which was my son, and I just wanted to commend them all for hard work. They started back in October, and they just finished this past Saturday, and it was a joy to watch. So That's it for me. Thank you.
You have many years to go. It'll be a lot of fun.
Anyone else?
Nope.
Great. Gentlemen, thank you. Going to move on to agenda item number 17, which is the minutes. And we have some minutes.
Move the minutes of February 2nd, 2010, and March 15th, 2011.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Vignani. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And finally, move the minutes of February 22nd, 2011. Joe, you're away.
Second. Seconded by Mr. Vignani. It's a three vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Unanimous. And now we're moving on to agenda item number 18, which is labor negotiations.
Point of order, Mr. Chairman. We do not need to have an executive session.
Wow, that's even better, folks. Agenda item 18, we are not going to go forward, which brings us to agenda item number 19, which is an adjournment.
Move to adjourn.
9 o'clock.
Second
by Mr. Harris. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. Thank you, folks. We'll see you next Tuesday. Have a good night. Thank you, John.